is Joya Scarlatta, and along with my co-host Pinaki Das, we welcome everyone to our August Technovate event, Economies of Cryptocurrencies, Artificial Intelligence, Blockchain, and Digital Currency. So for those who are new to our Technovate series, welcome, and I just wanted to give a very quick overview of what it is. Technovate is a monthly series where we invite speakers to discuss timely and relevant topics on a number of issues, ranging from upcoming technology trends to leadership and strategy to marketing and sales. We always post our upcoming events on our website and on our social media channels, so please be on the lookout. In fact, I'm excited to announce we have a great topic and speaker lined up for our Technovate event in September, which will be held in mid-September. And I'll give a slight teaser. It will be centered around artificial intelligence and customer service. So just like today's event, that one also will be an absolute wonderful one. So stay tuned. We will be announcing that very shortly. I also wanted to cover some very basic housekeeping rules. Please do not forget to mute yourself, and please hold off all questions till the end. If you do think of any questions, feel free to put them in the chat box and we will try to get to them all. Also, we will send the recording of this session within a few days. With that being said, I'm very excited to introduce today's topic and speaker. So since 2009, when Bitcoin entered the scene, we have been witnessing a rise of cryptocurrencies and crypto products. In addition, we are seeing both banks, major banks, and central banks exploring the adoption of these technologies for very large scale payments. So there are those who believe that crypto and blockchain technologies will have a major impact on future development of financial systems. So the question then is, how will this come into fruition? How will this come into play? Is it even feasible? And what are some of the challenges that may arise? Our speaker, Dr. Aman Agarwal, will address this and much more. So just a brief introduction of our celebrated speaker. Dr. Agarwal is currently the Dean, Director, and a Professor of Finance at the Indian Institute of Finance. He also serves as the Executive Editor of a quarterly journal of finance known as Finance India. He frequently appears on TV, print media, as well as the radio in regards to his experience on financial policies, education, capital markets, and economic scenarios of India, as well as the world. He also speaks at conferences around the world and has published over 74 research papers. So needless to say, he is a very busy individual, but it's an absolute honor to have him here. So everyone, please help me welcoming Dr. Agarwal to the Technovate stage, who will take this topic further. On to you, Dr. Agarwal.
Thank you, Jaya, for that brief introduction. Thank you, Ashok and Pinaki, to have me here at your forum. It's an honor to be speaking at Intera. Intera is like my other home, and Ashok is a very old friend. And I've always been very impressed when I listened to Joya's address recently at a Management Association's conclave, where she was invited to speak on artificial intelligence and digital marketing. It was an eye-opening and learning for me myself. Despite the fact that I have been in this space in terms of doing research, more of theoretical research than of practical implementation, which both Ashok and his team and Joya is more into than myself. So I will go now to the key topic of the address today, which is the economics of cryptocurrencies, artificial intelligence, blockchains, and digital currencies. We have been working on this particular issue for almost over 7 or 8 years now, and our outlays have been in the public domain, both in television, media, in print, from 2016 onwards. And we are happy to say that a large number of decisions by Government of India, including the former Finance Minister, Shri Arun Jaitley, and even the current Finance Minister of State and the others have got influenced by some of our works, including the Reserve Bank of India and some of the other central banks around the world, which have been looking at our work in terms of trying to introduce the central bank digital currency, which is a digital form. These works are our works, and I would like to say that they do not have any bearing of the views on the institution, but of the authors themselves. I would like to thank, before I begin, some of my colleagues from around the world who have helped me improve this work, which includes people like governors from Riksbank, from London Business School, from Jönköping Shopping in Sweden, Governor of Bank of Finland, Bank of Indonesia, who have actually helped us refine this work before we finally got it published in Finance India, way back in 2017-18. Some of the other people, apart from a group of almost about 100 plus people who have, only few are listed here, who have actually been mentioned, but many or more are there who have helped us refine our work from time to time. And I would be showing the recent work, which has actually got published in book by Bala Balachandran from NYU Stern, who has published the book just a couple of months back. We will be focusing the talk today, given the fact that I have half an hour with me, if I understand correctly, from Joya. So I will be focusing on some of these sections, but not all. This presentation will be available with Joya and the Ashok's team for distribution to people at large, whoever want to have access. And I will be happy to address any of the questions now or even later if they come across. And the full paper, as I said, is there in the Bala's book, which has been published, and that we will get to have a glimpse later in the slides as well. So we will begin with the modeling of the financial development and economic growth, going to artificial intelligence. Then I'll briefly touch in about a minute or two about the uncertain times, highlighting 2-3 points, and then move on to the economics of currencies, and then the conclusion at the end. I will be skipping large parts of section number 5 and section 6, which are on money supply and virtual community, which are commonly known today, which were not commonly known so much maybe a year or 2 years before, given the education which is getting dispersed through newspapers and televisions about virtual community and the virtual commodities like the cryptocurrencies. To begin with, I would like to point out, you know, this is something which we had built up as a model for almost about 20 years back. And we have been spoken of this model at the Italian Parliament, the Finnish Parliament, the Swedish Parliament, and various other government forums where we talk about the fact that there are these three main components or the factors which are required to induce actually sustainable development, which is technology, environment, and human capital. And this is something which is very critical. So it's a mix, an appropriate mix of technology, environment, and the human capital, which will ultimately lead to building sustainable development, which is actually bounded by finance as a flow, like the flow of blood in our body. So finance binds this to induce both the sustainable development and ultimately leading to employment, which is actually growth and well-being. Now, to explain this whole model, I'm happy to say the last 4 years of Nobel Prize, which have been given out, actually focus on something which we have been speaking for almost last 20 years as various forums. Almost from 2001, I have been speaking this particular model at various forums globally, as I said, including about 4 to 5 parliaments across the globe. So this is something which we keenly believe in, and this is even true today. It is not something which is not true today. It is even true today that we need to have an appropriate mix. And when we have tested this model, we have found that this is not something which is only eligible or workable at a macro level or an economy level. It is even workable at an institutional level, at a ground level, which is like an organization, where you need to have an appropriate mix of technology and good environment, which is both ecologically friendly, and a good human capital, which, you know, Ashok always keeps talking about, I know from our discussions, how important for him, because he is a technology firm runner. So technology is inbuilt, but then the human capital he keeps building on and trying to imbibe. So that these three things, which will actually bring in that sustainable environment to bring in that employment, growth, and well-being of the people at large. In any case, finance is critical in terms of making it happen. When we look at the Nobel Prize last year, you will see that it talks about how you know, the importance of improvement of auction theory has been discussed, and invention of new auction formats, which is, it talks about money as a common value, then talks about accountability, the counting of it, then knowledge and the human well-being. So again, this connects to what we have been talking about in our previous slide, which is technology, environment, and human capital binded by money, which induces employment and growth and well-being. Where they say to get an appropriate value of money, you need to have appropriate accounting tools, accountability, and the knowledge and for human well-being. So this is where this new auction theory, which has been given the Nobel Prize last year to Paul Milgram and Robert Wilson, talks about. When we go back to the Nobel Prize previous to this year, which was given to Abhijit Banerjee, Esther Dorfer, and Michael Kern, which again talks about the economic empowerment in building human capital, which is, they say that they have an experimental approach for evaluating global poverty. How do they do? They say, we are going to experiment at a very small level, at a grassroots level. Unless we remove the poverty, we will not be able to, in terms of food first, then only can the person start thinking about education. Then when they start getting feeding on education, then can they think about growth? So it is a question of inducing, you know, sustainability and developing that human capital from the very grassroots level. And they have used an experimental approach to do it. Again, it talks about all those three factors, which are critical, we have outlined in our model. Then the one previous to that was given to William Cordes and Paul Roman, which actually talks about how do you integrate climate, technology, and long-run economic growth curves. Now, you see, again, these three factors which we have outlined, if you see in our study, in our model, which is technology, environment, and human capital, get outlined very categorically here with integrated climate, technological innovations, and long-run economic growth curves. So when you have a long-run economic curve, you always have small short-run curves which make that long-run economic curve. So you always plan long and then you implement in short is always a policy which is taught in economic theory. And in any kind of a business cycle, you cannot, you know, implement in the long run. You have to implement in the short run. And this is where it talks about, again, this theory talks about knowledge and human well-being, where they want to introduce this for the well-being of the people at the end of the day. And so the integrated. So that is where we're looking at sustainable development. It is not only development, you know, it's not only growth. It is not, it's a question of sustainable development, which they're talking about, ultimately leading to growth and the well-being of the people. And this is where, you know, our work gets intertwined with some of the Nobel Prize, which have come out. And I'm happy that there is a sufficient kind of notification and interest, which is built in. And this is where actually artificial intelligence, blockchains, and even digital currencies come in due course. And as I go through my presentation, you will see how do I interlock all these things coming together today. Now, we developed this another model, which was there in 2005, which is financial development is a component of inflation and saving. And this is a way they have to balance out because inflation and saving moves opposite to each other. Either you have, if you have more inflation, savings get drained away. If you have more savings, then inflation goes down. So there is an appropriate balance which needs to be built in, more like the cost and profits which an organizations have. And that's where central banks come into play. There are some of the works which we have referred to extensively. One of the works which I would like to point out in specific, in any case, you can go through some of them, is the Chanakya's Kautilya, which is the Arthashastra, which I always say because Chanakya, in my opinion, is the real father of economics and not Adam Smith, because his work, which is the Arthashastra, is even valid today. You only need to replace the king by the president or the prime minister, and everything else is exactly the same. So his work, his chapters, everything is valid today in today's time, despite the fact that it has been written almost about 350 BCE. And whereas Adam Smith's work is not valid because it looks at consolidated and isolated environments, which is not valid today. Apart from that, interesting works are of Joseph Stiglitz, which talk about information dissymmetry, Hubert Stromlett on financial literacy, Mario Baldassari on economic, who was a former Minister of Economy in Italy, talks about the way economies challenge with disequilibriums, and then our works, which have been lately taken into account with the creation of central bank digital currencies around the globe. I'll just brush through this. I'm not going to go through all these points, but this is something which we are actually going through. And that actually brings in the need to bring in a balance, to bring in technology which can help us diverge and do things. We have seen a world which is a global disequilibrium, and there is an interdependence today which is required. So we have people, Joya, sitting in the United States. We have a team sitting in India here. We have another team sitting somewhere else. They're working together. It is not something that you're looking at. Today, when we hold these conferences or this webinar, we may have people from across the globe who may be attending and joining, and the knowledge spread is there. So there is that disequilibrium which gets created, but then there is an interdependence on each other. We learn from each other, and that's something which is very critical in when we're looking at structuring and understanding. Then that's where artificial intelligence and blockchain brings it on the same platform when we're looking at creating. So that is where the platform comes from, when it's a question of now not only looking at transacting, doing business, doing work, or communicating with each other, but even doing financial transactions with the e-rupee, which has been created by the government of India recently, with direct payments. No use need of any portal to go in through. You directly pay one to the other, like you pay cash. So these are something which are getting created on common platforms, which are actually using technology like artificial intelligence and blockchains. Then you have growth and unemployment, labor, key concerns areas, need for survivals. The focus is still there to interlock the global economic environment. Central banks have the same problems even today, where they want to manage banking and market responses. And this will become even further more complex with the digital currency, which we're talking about, if they do not implement it in the right way, like we have proposed in our paper way back in 2016 and 17. Then we have created some models, the CBDC and others. As I said, briefly, we'll touch upon them. This is something just to give you a glimpse of what has been happening. Today, the world population has an access. Today, a person on the street has an access. The Jan Dhan accounts created by the government of India, Prime Minister, the demonetization which took place did enforce a large community in this country. You see, I remember credit cards talking about the fact when they came in the 70s saying that, oh, we are going to be the next currency of the world. So everyone will do credit, have credit cards and do transactions. But even in large countries like United States or Europe, about 40 to 45, 50% is still cash currency still existing in countries, including India, which was there. We were around almost 80, 85%. Now, understand the fact that there is a comfort which we get from cash. But there was this community in this country, the lowest possible community, which would not leave cash, whatever kind of education could have been given. But demonetization and Jan Dhan account, two components, have actually made them completely digital. Today, you go on a street vendor, you can buy tea, coffee, a matchbox or a small thing. You don't need to have cash. You can do it through a digital payment gateway, a structure. They take it. And that has increased security for them, because when they used to sell in cash, at the end of the day, when they were taking cash, they had problems of theft. They had problems with the fact that maybe some friend will come and have them take away for a drink or something. Now, all that money goes into an account, and they can now think about looking at growth for their family, looking at how can they build the family going together. And this is something which is critically important for that community. So this digital empowerment in that community segment, which is roughly about 1/4 of the population of this country. We're talking about a size of a population of this size of United States of America is what we have as a lower middle class in this country, almost about 400 million people. Now, those people have got empowered with these two components, which Narendra Modi introduced when coming up. Some things which we have seen digital. Again, I'll be skipping these slides just to enlighten, since many of you might have technological backgrounds, you will know that this is the kind of influx which we have seen happen in the world around. I would like to move to the artificial intelligence component. Today, when we look at artificial intelligence and the society as an interplay, we organized a seminar when we released a book on artificial intelligence. Prabhat Kumar Ashok was also there about 2 years back at the campus, while we were still in a normal mode, not in the virtual mode framework. Agriculture is a key area. We're looking at not only transferring technology, transferring goods, we're creating e-mandis which are taking place. I have proposed a mobile mandi framework wherein products can be there to increase the remuneration which a person gets at the end, the agriculturist gets. Now, this all needs the artificial intelligence. If we do not have that artificial intelligence built in, then we do not know today what kind of product is being produced where and where is it kept. I remember when I was at Columbia University, we did a project for the HMOs in the United States, the medical framework. Now, they had different HMOs all across United States. Each one of them had reservoirs of organs and all. But then if I wanted an organ, I had to register with that hospital. And then I will be told that what is my number of waiting, which I'll be there. It was a simple ERP at that time, which could have been developed. We proposed to them that they should develop an ERP package wherein they could actually, if I need to get a kidney replacement, I register and they can tell me that I can get it done at this hospital in California or in Chicago or in New York. And this will be my number if I want to do. But that did not do because they did not want to basically lose their power of the organ. So everyone had to register every time in a hospital. Now, this is where artificial intelligence comes into play. When you have these agriculture producers, when you have rural and urban divides taking place or information asymmetry, this will help allocate those resources in a manner which will be the best use. So when we're looking at smart cities today, talk about that's rural and urban. National security, we're already seeing what is happening today. It's not something which is, we are looking at the Afghan war. We're looking at what is happening. Different countries are taking decisions on national security, what can happen, what will not happen. Sitting at wherever they are, we saw some of the infringements which took place recently in India. Again, how India reacted to it. Sitting, drones being used, tracking and other things. Now, these are something, again, artificial intelligence and blockchains helps build in. When you look at healthcare, today, operations can be done sitting across the country. You don't need to move a doctor like it used to be. Oh, you have to either move the patient from one place to the other, or you have to move the doctor from one place to the other. Certainly, you need to have a patient at a hospital which has the requisite equipment. But today, operations can be conducted in Africa, a country like Africa, by a doctor sitting in the United States. Now, this is something where in the healthcare framework has got upgraded to a framework where they are using these technologies to build in a better environment for people, women, social welfare, similarly youth, jobs and growth. That's where our national labor exchange is proposed. That's what the model which Arvind Kejriwal and Rozgar Exchange proposed is based on the national labor exchange, which we have talked about more like a stock market. Similar is the case with the UP chief minister talking about the national labor exchange being created wherein appropriate people can come in. Now that will use artificial intelligence. If you have to match labor hours with the payment gateways and structures and the employment needs and the employer and the employee needs to come forward. The MSME sector is using it extensively now. Some of these big companies which are into retail framework are using some of these networks. Then you have infrastructure development, still not using it, but we hope we'll see banking, taxation, and monetary frameworks in any case, which we're going to discuss in a few moments. Some of the places we feel where some of these technologies are being used, and we have contributed extensively in terms of money laundering bill, Kisan credit card, invest tax incentives, curbing international money laundering, post office banking, which we have proposed, and the assumption we have been implemented, the cryptocurrency and all. So some of these things which we have been talking about actually use these technologies. Now, within a minute or two, I will rush you through this thing about uncertain times and how life with corona is fostering digital influx. Now, it is something which we people say, oh, it's an end of the world. Oh, something is happening. Disaster is happening. But my dear friends, it's not for the first time. For ages, these kind of things have been happening. We look at the history of the epidemics for over 3,000 years. We have seen these histories. Silk Road, 3000 BC, Plague of Athens, 430. In Plague of Athens, the whole Athens was destroyed. They said the end of world has come. Similarly, when it came to the Black Death in 1340s, half of the whole city was destroyed. The American plague, large number of people, millions of people were destroyed. Did the world end? We are still talking to each other. We're still communicating, still existing. So this is where there is a large hope in terms of wanting to go up. The Great Plague of London, the Great Plague of Marseille, 2/3 of the city of Marseille was completely wiped off because of the Great Plague of Marseille. Is Marseille still not there? Is France still not there? A lot of things have happened. So it is not. And even today, we have some of these still existing, like the AIDS is still existing. H1N1 is still existing. West Africa, Ebola, we started, is still existing. Some of them are still existing. It is not that they're over. The world goes on. We develop, we breathe, we grow forward. And this is where we need to see that hope coming forth. Now, I'd like to spend another 2 or 3 minutes on coming on the economics of currency. It's important. You see, everybody sees these products, Bitcoins and others, which are there. Or they say they are cryptocurrencies. First of all, you need to understand the fact that when you talk over the word currency, it is a matter of money. It's a medium of exchange. It's a unit of account. And it has a store of value. Now, where does that store of value come from? The store of value comes from the total assets which a country has. The currency is a reservoir of the total assets. When you talk of the US dollar, the total assets of United States of America, whether publicly held or privately held, I'm again saying, whether publicly held or privately held, whether Ashok holds them or the government of the United States holds them, all those assets are taken together, which will actually strengthen the US dollar. Similarly, the Indian rupee is strengthened by the total assets of this country, which includes the ones which are held by the government of India and held by you and me, who are citizens of this country. The total assets of those countries are taken in, and that's what builds in the store of value of that currency. Now, when we talk of Bitcoins or any of such crypto products, as I refer to them as, they do not have a store of value. They have a unit of account. They do have a ledger. They do have tradable values, correct? But they do not have a store of value. Like, I give you a simple example. When you go to a casino, I have not been to one, but I have seen it in movies. You have these chips, which people used to trade, play with on the casino. Now, those chips have an equivalent value to a dollar or a local currency there. But otherwise, does it have a store of value? It does not have a store of value. Can it be used as a medium of exchange? Can I use that chip, one chip, in another casino? I cannot. That chip is restrained to that casino. That means within a group of people, I can use that as an exchange value. But beyond that, I cannot use that as a medium of exchange. So that's where the word currency, which stands to money. And we have a full 3 or 4 page segment on how money got created. What is the importance of money? Why does it value? How does the store of value comes in the book, in the chapter, and the articles which we have published, which actually talk about it if you want to understand more. Now, this is very critical. And this is where which is missing in, firstly, the products like Bitcoins and others. That's why we support the creation of such crypto products, more like central bank digital currencies, which are by the central bank, so that this particular store of value is maintained there. The correct measure of money, which is narrow abroad, gets missing then. Narrow means more liquid, less liquid. In any case, we are not here. Most of you are not from, I believe, from economics background. So I will not go into details, but narrow and broad, I'm basically classified in macroeconomics. The cryptocurrency is in Yukta. We have seen gold, silver, leather, wood, metal, some of these parts, even stones at a point of time being used. So there can be products which are being used, like some of these product companies are now adhering to some of the Bitcoins as a medium of exchange. But would it be acceptable? What will be happening? And I'll go through in a due course. The value of the wealth, which is the national money exchange, the bank, the government issued paper or coins, authenticity, which was there given to stones, which was there given to tobacco or plastic or paper or metal before, is not there with some of these crypto products as of today. And where does it go, the value for an asset class? This is where the asset class definition we have in the securities market theory, in portfolio theory, the definition of an asset class. This is where the asset class definition differs from a real framework. And that's where the monetary aggregates come in. Now, when we proposed this, we said we need to create an M5, which M5 contains all these. If you see the tick mark in the green is what it all contains in M5. So when they need to create this, we measure M3 in India. Large number of countries do these different measures, and all of these are taken into consideration. But when they need to introduce, they will have to introduce M5. Now, I will not go into details here again, because we are going to talk about artificial intelligence and others, but not so much on the money supply portion. But this is important for you to understand, because then how will a government or a central bank monitor what kind of a currency is prevalent in the market? How much is prevalent and how much is not prevalent? So M5 is nothing else but M3, but cryptocurrencies, which is being proposed by us. Currently, there are these countries which have actually introduced. Venezuela introduced petrodollar in 2018, which actually had to close down, primarily because of the fact that they hedged it against petrol, which was fine because then it created an asset value. But then there were no petrol reserves. There were no oil reserves. So they had to go bust. Otherwise, India is creating. China is looking at it from 2019 onwards. United States of America has also now started talking about. The Federal Reserve Bank has said recently in their articles that they want to create a central bank digital currency. If they create, what will be the fate of Bitcoins and others? We do not know. But as of today, Bitcoins and all are legitimate part of the cryptocurrency framework in the United States and Japan in particular, but in large number of countries, including China and India and Venezuela, they are not. Now, what is important is this fiat currency. If it is a digital currency, it becomes a fiat currency, but it is not, then it does not become a fiat currency, which is important again. Some of the countries which actually do not have these currencies as an acceptable component. In India, now they're allowing it to trade in stock exchange, like paper, like equity, like debt, but not as a medium of exchange. Something which we did way back, published in June 2018. You can see immediately after that, the news came in September 2018, where they created a panel to create virtual currencies based on what we suggested. This was an interview in Delhi in 2018 beginning by DD India, Delhi Doordarshan India, which again talked about it, a 15-minute interview. This was a recent interview which took place, and you can see the statement where the Minister of State clearly says the government explores use the blockchains technology.
Professor Aman, you are muted. We can't hear you.
Sorry. I said that this particular thing clearly said, the Minister of State said the government will explore use of that tech. This is what I said in this particular interview just about 2-3 days before this particular news item came in Economic Times. And he said in response, so they are clearly looking at what we have been talking about. You can listen to this interview on the Rajasthan Patrika's website as well as on our YouTube channel, and you will see what we have, what I have said is exactly what is mentioned by the minister here, and even the statement by the finance minister thereupon. These are the links to these interviews if you want to have an access to them. This is a book which actually is a full paper on the topic which we are discussing today in length. And so now about rough, running in about 100 pages there in this book. This book got published only last year, as I said. This book got published, this year beginning. And it's got released, I think, November or December last year. But then the efficiency decision making, very good, interesting articles which are there. Now, in any case, again, as I said, the asset value creation is the critical in the money. Again, as I said, I will be skipping this money supply component as of now and moving on. These are some critical components which are there when we look at. And this is very well established by European community and in central banks, where they clearly say how virtual products are different from currencies. And these are some of the points that they have outlined, which are critical in understanding the behavior, the bidirectional behavior and all, and how it's important to understand the electronic mode or the digital. And this is where, why central banks are resisting accepting some of these currencies. Would they disappear? No, they will still be remaining there. They will still there. Blockchain is not something which is cryptocurrency. Blockchain is a technology which can be used in all platforms, and that will be used. And it's a very good technology, although it's not impermeable, but it will still be used. As I said, I will be skipping these because I need to focus on. Now, this is something which is there. Just a second. These are something which are important virtual, which are parameters for virtual product, which is value basis, stability, liquidity, information efficiency, accessibility, regulator. And because we don't want something coming up and going A and Y. And this is why it's important that the transparency and regulators are there as part of it. And this is some critical questions which don't get answered when it comes to Bitcoins and some of such product, crypto products. Important to understand the Indian rupee, it is not new. And it has not been new even internationally. You'll be surprised, it has been a floating currency since 1978. And it has been floating in the Arabic region with a different color, but it has been there. And so it is very well accepted currency for over 1000 BCE. And that's where it gets its strength. Some things which the government is trying to implement, the online banking is still at a very nascent stage in India. In the United States, fairly advanced, but in India, it's still at a nascent stage. But with the e-rupiah, which the Prime Minister has launched, I think we are going to move to the next stage. Post office banking, which we proposed way back in 2008-16, I'm happy came into light. Banking on wheels is still not there. Agro-banking is still very at nascent stage, which needs to be there, but Kisan Credit Card was there. Now, all these things utilize, these are something which utilize artificial intelligence if you want to make them efficient in terms of deliverables today to the people at large. It is not a question of only having a facility. It's a question that each right person throughout the country gets access to it. And that is only possible when we introduce artificial intelligence and blockchains in these frameworks, which are coexisting as of today. Whether it's Aadhaar card, a very good example of what we use technology. I remember being interviewed in a Forbes magazine for this about 2 years back, where I talked about the interplay of Aadhaar card and how it will become, although the Supreme Court at that time did restrict Aadhaar card usage, but then finally it is there. And now the way it is coming at as a social security number, which is there in the United States. These are some of the questions before us, which we need to answer, which is, what are we looking at? Financial inclusion, banking, digital dividend, the bottom billions. That's what the important is. We need to service them. We need to cater to them. Whether it's a question of business, whether it's a question of education, whether it's a question of financial empowerment. And that's where we need to use these technologies going in. Bridging disability divides through digitalization. Internet as a public good already is being discussed. We are seeing it in the state of Delhi. We're seeing it in other states as well, where they're making smart cities. It's going to be a public good. Skills, labor market, jobs and productivity to be equitably. People from across the globe should be able to coexist with each other. Money laundering, privacy and security concerns need to be under check. And that's where we will see the importance of restricting some of these Bitcoins and which virtual products will come in. Economies of online sourcing, empowering women. Today, women are doing large amount of business across small households. They're doing businesses using technology, using payment gateways. This would not have been possible 10, 15 years back. Women could not think. And these are women even in rural India. Even a kisan women can do it, sitting at across with non-digital. Now there's technology where you can transfer money where you don't even need internet today. You can actually transfer from one mobile to the other, which was there. I remember Stephen Schaeffer mentioning to me at London Business School, when I was visiting London Business School way back in 2003-04. And then he was mentioning that, in Africa he's working on, that they transfer millions of dollars from one mobile to the other without the government coming to know. Those are called black dollars, illegal, but still they could transfer billions of dollars across a mobile phone. But this, he was still studying that. Now we are talking about that transferring only about 4-5 years back in India, legitimately. But this was happening in Africa way back in the 90s and the early 2000s. And this is what Stephen Schaeffer was actually studying when he was doing his research in London Business School. He's a full professor there. It's empowering them. Fragile states, resilient digital economy. Social fabric and human race is a critical component still being discussed. Are we going to lose that touch? The touch which I had with Ashok sitting over a cup of coffee in my office or in his office or at a lounge or at a restaurant. Is that going to go away? We have everything as a barrier, but does not mean that's going to go away. Where does the axe road lead to? These are some things which need to be looked upon, where we look upon how do we build them up? How do we integrate some of these technologies to induce agriculture manufacturing services? That is why we are seeing today the way the world has engulfed some of these technologies. Today we are seeing growth. We are seeing numbers grow up, auto numbers going up. We are seeing banking showing profitability. For the last so many years, banks have not shown profitability. For the last 1.5 years, they're showing profitability. Healthcare industry showing profitability. Healthcare-related industry is showing profitability. Even shipping industry, one of my friends who is heading as the president of the Association of Shipping Industry said, the shipping industry has shown for the first time profitability in the last 10 years. In a decade, they have not shown that profitability as has shown last year because of the use of some of these technologies and advantage cutting down costs and increasing their profitability, jobs growth. So digital finance, banking, educating, social media. Today, the government is now thinking of taking education to the people at large. They introduced a large number of TV channels to introduce. They're now using digital platforms so people could study on mobiles. Does not need to be a smartphone. It could be a normal Android phone. They're trying to bring in that technology where students can study through an Android phone as well. Now communicating, transferring. Now this is empowering. Introducing transparency. Recently, the government of Delhi, Arvind Kejriwal introduced no RTOs, locked every RTO office. I saw it in screen today again. They said RTO office locked by Arvind Kejriwal. Everything online. Today you want license, you want renewal of ROs, everything can be done online. This is bringing in transparency in governance, which has been talked about, what we have been looking for. The privacy issues are certainly concerns. I'll take another 2-3 minutes, Zoya, if you allow me. I'm just coming to the conclusion.
Sure.
Thank you. Social fabric, access to information, which is a key. And let me tell you, my dear friends, I work with the Bureau of Indian Standards, which is the Government of India body. I've been a chairman, co-chairman of various committees there. And about 12 years back, we were working on digital paperless offices. And at that time, I met some of the executives from the top companies in India in IT framework, which are known worldwide. And they said the kind of information they have on individuals, the kind of information they have on hand, if they make it public, it can be a roar. It can be a big privacy issue. Each move of every one of us is getting actually encaptured somewhere or the other, despite various encryptions, despite Zoom having encryption, even this is happening. I remember we had a conference, the second or third international conference, where Shri Kiran Bedi was speaking, who was the governor of Puducherry. You'll be surprised. Her video, after the talk was over, we recorded the whole 3-hour session and we got the recording from Zoom. But her 10-minute talk, exactly from when she started to when she ended, was not there because her office might have instructed Zoom to remove that component. Exactly that period. However, I did have photographs. So we have her photographs in the video which we have put online, but we do not have her exact words for that 10, 15 minutes which she spoke. Exact timing was cut and we could not. Now, this is where governance plays a role. Access of information is there with the government, with various agencies across the globe. So social fabric gets influenced. Risk due to cybersecurity, which is there, a lot talked by Jayashree Pandya, a co-op colleague of mine from United States in New York. A government concern on control, money laundering, terroristic threats. Bitcoin's a sovereignty threat, which is there, which Finance Minister Arun Jaitley announced as not legal in his union budget, which is based on our work and our work only, then in any case, virtual currencies which are there. Just to conclude with two slides before I end the presentation, AI and blockchains. If you thought I'm going to talk about the way neural networks work, I was not supposed to talk. I am talking about the way it interacts with society, the way it interplays in our life, the way it interplays in your and my life today. The AI and blockchains are integral part of human well-being. To resist them is a futile task. Any government, any organization, any institution, any individual who resists the introduction of AI and blockchains in his or her life, he likes it or doesn't like it, it's not a matter of choice. These are part of our well-being today and tomorrow. It's a question of how do we adapt them? How do we embrace them? How do we make use of them for the betterment of human mankind? Cryptocurrencies by central banks, called the central bank digital currencies, is the way forward. You will see that others will disappear, which I call crypto products. They will not completely disappear. They will coexist. There is a huge dark market, a black market, which will still transact. And that has become a very efficient way of transaction without noticing, although it gets caught. Recently, when we saw the Kundra case come up, we saw the way cryptocurrencies were used to transact and transfer money, illegitimate money, to give bribes and others. So it will still happen. Till they are traced, they are not traceable. But once they are traced, then certainly they will create a havoc at that time. And that's where the need to central banks launching it the way we have proposed is important. Regulatory prudence is critical in the whole framework. Role of central bank governance and government is critical. Bridging that gap between artificial intelligence society, it's not only a part of educational institutions like ours or organizations like InterIIT, but equally an important duty of the governments of each country and state to actually go about people understanding, because it's a new frame, it's a new animal. One has to embrace it, one has to live with it, one has to enjoy it. And to do that, they need to make it more habitable, make it understandable what exactly this is, so that there is no repulsion going against the AI. Financial growth and development, financial equitable social welfare society is there. Technology as an enabler is to be seen. It is already there as part of our life, day-to-day life. Introducing M5 as a monetary framework needs to be there. The e-rupiah launched by Digital Framework will be a key marking step in the creation of CBDC in India. Last slide for me to conclude. Vision 2030 is going to be on jobs, growth, and simplification with the induction of AI, blockchains, digital currencies, and the interplay between humans and technology. We have to embrace all of them. And that's where we're going to see the jobs come and go. Things will dynamically change. We need to learn to adapt ourselves. World economy is moving to a new economic order. Re-emergence of a multipolar economic global possibility is there. It is no longer the fact that you have defense power or you have money power or you have political power or you have some other kind of muscle power. Today, each zone has a different power. Some place they have money power. Some place they have energy power. Like Russia has energy power. Europe, they can squeeze Europe within a few seconds by stopping the electricity supply, because the whole of Europe depends on electricity. 70% of electricity needs comes from Russia. So if they stop electricity, Europe will collapse. So you can imagine the kind of interdependence which is in Europe, and that's why you'll never see Europe actually talking a negative about Russia per se. Then financial needs for US.
If you look at the inflows in the United States for over the last 100 years, about 70% of the inflows comes from Europe. Business comes from Europe. It goes again, but large part of it comes from Europe and from other developing countries. When it looks at trade in India, today we have trade with almost all countries. India as a knowledge hub, as a technology hub is coming up, but as a knowledge hub, it's one of the strongest hubs. Science and technology is very strong in India. Now, these are different multipolar zones which are coming up in the world. And each interdependent, as I said, on each other. There's a disequilibrium, but then we are interdependent on each other. Whether it is China, even there, China is interdependent. We're seeing in Afghanistan every day, equations changing. Who is coming forth? Who is not coming forth? Who is wanting what? What is stand coming forth? What will be there? These are powers which are redistributing themselves. So you cannot talk of one power today. It's a multipolar economic globe which is coming to. The stress needs to be on social security systems, facilities. Why? The people who have contributed, the elderly who have contributed to the world at large, who have given their youth to the growth of the youth and this world, need to be taken care of. So social fabric needs to be developed, whether you follow capitalistic structure or a socialistic. Now this COVID happened, United States of America, Ashok was telling me, gave a large chunk of money to people, transferred money to direct. Even in India, they did it. Even to companies, they did it. But this is nothing else but a social security. That is a net which is there. You require that kind of a net. You know, whether it's all old organizations, small organizations, elderly, they need that fabric which is there. Environment and social equilibrium in the society, business and employment growth. And as I always like to quote, the Buddha's Eightfold Path, the right views, the right decision, right speech, right action, right living, right struggle, right thoughts, and right meditation is something which can build that equitable. These all will intertwine with AI, blockchains, and the digital framework we're looking at. And to last is something which I always spoke for last 28 years of my addressing various forums, which is trust and confidence holds key to growth and prosperity. If we do not have trust and confidence on each other, on anything, on a medicine, on a doctor, on my teacher, on my student, on my employer, on my employee, I cannot look at growth and prosperity. I can only see growth and prosperity when I have trust and confidence on the other. And this is something which is very critical in terms of doing any kind of relationship, in building any kind of understanding or growth for tomorrow. Thank you. In any case, the others are some things about the Institute. I'll just brush them through and go to the last slide. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal, for a very enlightening session. I definitely learned a lot. I'm going to pass it on to Pinaki, who will head up the Q&A section. Pinaki, on to you.
Thank you, Joya, and thanks a lot, Professor Aman, for a very wonderful, insightful session today. Always a pleasure listening to you, not only for the knowledge of the subject, but also, you know, how eloquently you put across, you know, things. And friends, like, once again, good evening, good morning, et al. To all of you from wherever you are attending the program. And now we move on to the Q&A session for today's TechnoWait. And there have been a lot of questions which have been coming in through chat. Now, some of those questions are very long. So it's taken me a while to actually categorize the questions. So I want to thank all of you for, you know, for those questions. So the way I will do it, Professor, is that I'm putting it in certain categories. Because maybe, you know, say security is a category. So there are three or four questions.
Sure.
I will just, you know, so that we can have as much coverage as possible and see how we can do till 9, and then we can take a call. How many more we could probably do. So one question, like, which I found from a couple of people is on, you know, they are using the term mining of cryptocurrencies. So by mining, you know, it's like, just like a mint is mining coins or notes, or a coal mine, a mine mines different minerals. So the question, so one of the question is about, you know, the limit on mining of, mane hum note chhapte hi rahenge kya? So how does one, with respect to cryptocurrencies, Is there any limit on how much of it can, how much of currency can be mined? Yes. So this was one, and another one. I just found it very amusing. So this is like, you know, the Bitcoin network. How do you know who is a solo miner and who is the mining pool? Who is the ganglord kind of thing? So this was on mining.
So you want me to respond one by one, or you want me to put forward all the...
You can combine, you can just...
Okay, sure.
Communication.
So let me just respond to this mining part. First of all, when it comes to these Bitcoins, which is the virtual products, so they use these mining devices. Like, there is a diagram which is showing actually the mining framework, how does it mine. So they have a machine which actually mines out these, like you rightly said, when you mine coal or you mine gold coin, gold or something like that. In case of the central bank digital currency, what we have proposed is there is no need of mining. It is actually only changing the paper currency into a digital platform. So instead of, like, you know, today you might be getting your salary, you don't get it in paper. So it's all digital framework, but you have to use various intermediaries to actually transact that. In cash, you don't use intermediaries. So this is where e-repair comes in framework, where the intermediaries tend to disappear and you have transaction of digital currency from one to the other directly. And that's where the digital currency needs to be there. If it is not a digital currency, then you have to have payment gateways like you use from banks to transfer money from one to the other. Then you can directly transfer that money when you have that money in my account to one to the other. And in any case, necessary security blocks need to be used. Now, as far as mining is concerned, you see, there's a very critical question. Till when can you print money? Who has the right to print money? The first question is that. And that is why the central banks come as an important. Because when the central banks do it, when we say a rupee, the value of a rupee, where, you know, 75, we normally say 75 rupees a dollar, 74 rupees a dollar. It is an exchange which gets basketed out. But then how do we get it? It's the value of all the assets in this country taken into account, which actually becomes that store value. Now, this is where the mining by a central bank, which is done, of how much is to be printed and how much is not to be printed, is kept in taking into account that M3 value today. And that's what I'm saying is to be M5 once the digital currencies are there, which take into account the digital framework as well. And that will constrain as to how much should you print and how much should you not print. As far as mining of these blockchains of which virtual products is concerned, that is constrained by that miner, which is there, the kind of capabilities it has, what it does. Now, even there are questions which are there. Some people legitimately say it is right. Some people don't. Like in a casino, who has a printing power of printing a chip? Now, you can always, a person who is running a casino can always print those chips and put it on the table. Now, there has to be a limit and they control it. So that's where who is going to control it becomes important. And that's where the difference between the cryptocurrencies as well as central bank digital comes into play. But the role of miner, as you rightly said, is critical. But M5 in case of central banks will help contain that factor, because that will help them understand how much should we allow it to be there in the market. Like as of today, roughly about 10 to 11% of M3 is increasing every year. That means new money is coming in, 10 to 11%. Whereas earlier, even when Raghuram Rajan was there, the influx was about 15-16%. And prior to that also, about 17 to 18% used to be the money supply increase every year. That is M3. That means new currency used to come in every year. So the government used to look at the growth of business, other things, and keep that money supply in framework and then print accordingly.
Thank you, Professor Aman. And I'm actually getting a lot of questions on regulation. So at least 4 or 5 people, they are talking about, you know, how do you see the growth of cryptocurrencies in a market like India? And what are the chances that the government is going to put in some regulation or completely? You mentioned about 72 countries, they were having some, something or the other. And USA and Japan, they actually have this thing going on there. So there are questions on, in different ways people have asked, is there any effort to regulate cryptocurrency in Indian market?
First of all, when you talk of crypto products, which are referred to as cryptocurrencies like Bitcoins or others, and the problem with them is that you do not know who is the controlling agency. Where exactly are they being held? Are they being held in the United States or Japan or Venezuela or Cambodia or Vietnam or in Germany or France or in New Zealand? Where exactly is the mining station? Where is it clouded at? Where is the wallet?
nothing is known about them. It is completely opaque. And through blockchains, they're able to transfer and do business, but then it is completely opaque what goes on where. And that is where, when it comes to regulation, no one can regulate them. Because which country regulation will come in? The person who created mining and mined them and then sold it off to the people at large. And then people like, let us say, A, B, and C in India, in Germany, in France are holding it. Would the German, that country's regulations apply? Or would the person who created a regulation apply? Or where the cloud services are being used will apply? Or where the wallet is held will apply? Or where the blockchain is being run by that machine will apply? It is not known. So that is where one of the biggest regulation impediments is there in those cases. Okay. Secondly, when it comes to virtual currencies, which are digital currencies, which are being introduced by central banks. Now, this is where I said even the Federal Reserve Bank is now talking about introducing a Federal Reserve Bank digital currency. Now, that will be controlled by the Federal Reserve Bank, like the dollar is controlled or the rupee is controlled. So that will be automatically, something happens today, I can approach the Reserve Bank of India and say, this is a fraud. I need a recourse for this. I need this money in my account. But in case of Bitcoins and others, there is no recourse at all. And this is where it's important there's a regulation. That is why 72 countries are still not allowed. And in India, as far as I'm concerned, and what if the government has been so far responding to what we have been saying, it will not make it a legitimate transactional currency or a currency as a currency for transaction. It can be used on exchanges, which is being used according to the Supreme Court order. That means you can trade it like equity and debt as paper, as a product. You can buy and sell like gold, but it will not have that currency value, which is there. So it can be traded. It can have, that's where you see the value. Actually, one day it goes up to 40,000, then 50,000, then 20,000. Now currency doesn't change that way. You don't have a rupee going up to, you know, 1 rupee is valued at $100,000 and then the next day it is valued at 50 cents. It doesn't go that way. So it's not a currency. That's where it becomes a product and not a currency. I hope I'm able to clarify about this regulation part because it's very confusing. And they say that there are regulations, but there are no regulations which can control it. And that is why I said this currency will exist. This will not disappear. This will be the dark market currency for ages to go ahead. Like in India, we say, even today we have bullock carts. Even today we have people running rickshaws in certain parts in Kolkata and West Bengal. Maybe other parts of India also. But they are more prominent, visible in Kolkata, but other parts it may be there also. So they're still there. So nothing disappears. Similarly, we will see them just go underground, but they will still exist.
Thank you, Professor Aman. So maybe what I'll do is, because we are already at 8:57, let me take two more questions and try to be as succinct as possible, because I can see, you know, 1100 chats. I've not even read them.
Oh my God.
But let me move to another category. So this may be, again, there were some questions on this. So this is related to security. So security of, let me just take up one of the questions. So as I understand, cryptocurrencies are not technically stored anywhere. So evidence of holding is on the blockchain. So how can it be secure from cyber theft? You had one slide on, so where cyber theft was mentioned. And there are a few other questions also where people have, somebody has spoken about Taliban playing a terrorist and making bad use of cryptocurrency and a few other, security kind of questions. If you can.
Yes. First of all, please understand that they are stored in a wallet. So there is a wallet where they get stored in. Okay. They are used through blockchains to transfer from one person to the other when one wants to sell them to one to the other. And those are encrypted in a manner that no one else comes to know, only the transferor knows. Suppose someone, and there have been theft cases in the UK and other parts of the world. Even recently, one of the crypto exchanges, the whole crypto was taken away by a hacker. And then later on returned by the hacker saying that, look, your blockchain is not impermeable and I can steal. And my objective was not to steal, but to show to you that is not impermeable. So even blockchain technology per se is not non-breakable. It is breakable. It's a question of how it is written and how it is structured. The importance is that blockchain is certainly a very secure environment. It is a very good technology and the government of India is considering to use it. And even it will be used in a digital currency launched by the government of India, but not the way we see as blockchain. They may write the whole thing themselves because it's a computer programming which is done.
So they may write the whole algorithm themselves. But as far as the theft is concerned, you see, when you have good people, when you have a lock, you have a key. So there will always be good and bad people. And as I said, there will always be these thefts which will keep taking place for something or the other. I remember the way computers were attacked. Organizations are attacked. My colleague here, they know about the kind of attack they have also suffered in their organization. The way they the money is being charged. Now, most of these people who conduct these thefts today, they don't take cash, dollar, rupee anymore. They only take bitcoins. Why? Because then once it is transferred to them, it is difficult to trace them at all. And they can be sitting anywhere in the world. This is where I say there is a big risk. Despite the fact that United States and Japan has been promoters of this technology, which is a very good technology, but there are these restrictions and the negative components to it, which actually are impediment for non-growth of these virtual products or cryptocurrencies as known around the world. As I said, they would be traded on the markets. You could actually buy some of these products, but not as a transactional value, not as a currency per se.
So thank you, Professor Aman. I would just add a corollary to this question. I've got a question from one of our organization leaders from the US, from Ranjan Guho. So this is again on security. So he says, if you lose your password, do you lose the money? I understand there is no way to recover the password.
Correct. You see, this is a myth again. First of all, yes, you cannot, even the miner actually who has a logbook can actually get it out for you. But you cannot come to know. If you have lost those numbers, digital, and that will remain even with your digital currency. If you have a digital currency account, like if you have a bank account, you don't have a password, you can't do transaction. So that will be there even there. The only difference is when a hacker can hack and take out all that money, that means that money is stored somewhere, whether it is in the form of bitcoins or whatever. And if the hacker can do it, then naturally the miner and who is controlling the ledger, because there is a ledger account which is maintained. How would someone come to know who is holding ultimately? So there is a ledger book which is maintained, which is clearly mentioned in all blockchain cryptocurrency frameworks. So when that ledger is there, whoever has access to that ledger can actually come to know what is there and they can break it up. But then for an individual who has it, it will be very difficult because he is going to be a small component of the whole chain. And since he's going to be a small component to the whole chain, it will be very difficult. Or if you have a huge chunk of money, then you can always hire a hacker to do it for you and then pay off a small amount of bitcoins for that purpose. Like, you have to go to a bank, you may have to pay a charge and get your password again if you lose your password and forget your password. So there are these things which is there. So it is not something which is not there. IT people always will find a way. It's not something which cannot be done. It is something which is very much there. And as I said, if hackers can do it, anyone else can do it all the time.
Thank you, Professor Aman. We can actually just go on and on. Like I can see the chats coming up, but I will just take one last area.
Sure.
So this is related to investment and income. So this is more like a personal, ironical that it's coming, from someone like me who's not really good at investment. But there are folks who understand their money very well. So the question is very simple. It's is crypto a good long-term investment? So obviously the people, they are looking at crypto as an investment. And then there are one or two other questions also. Somebody who's interested in, who has been following the prices of certain cryptocurrencies. So there is a volatility. You had mentioned about this sometime back. So what are the factors that drive that, those price variations? And if I may add a third one, which is Lionel Messi, for example, he's just shifted from Barcelona to PSG, to that French club. And apparently a huge part, it's rumored, huge part of his compensation is cryptocurrency. The question was, how does one calculate income and corresponding taxes and those kind of things?
Certainly. The tax framework is very clear. The day you actually put it on your account, when you convert it to whatever dollar, peso or a euro or whatever, the tax will be applicable according to that. So tax part is very clear on it. So there's no problem of elucidation on taxes. And as of today, capital gains is charged on these products because they're tradable assets. whether it is a short-term capital gain or a long-term capital gain. Like if you buy a house or sell a house, or you buy gold or sell a gold and things like that, we have long-term and short-term capital gains, or you buy shares. That is the treatment of taxation as of today in India and around the world also. Okay. Now, when you talked about the fact of investment, you see, what is investment? Investment is something which you see grow in front of you. Okay. Whether it is short-term or long-term, it can be either. In India, people invest in their children. They see them grow. Now, he could be a rug tomorrow. You know, he may completely shunt you out and throw you out of your own house. That could also happen. But then you invest, built on that block. Okay. When you have products like crypto products, which are traded, they are more like day traders. Every day it is shifting up and down, high level of volatility. So it is more like the Satta Bazaar, as is called in Hindi, or a currency for gambling, then more of an investment. Some people have used it and made money. It's more of gambling, as I said, because if you do not understand the markets well, so like the share market, so there are people who invest in share. When they say invest, meaning they take a share, they hold on to the share for a couple of number of days or years. It is not that they are buying a share today and tomorrow they sell it and they say, oh, I made 20 bucks on a share, and that's called investment. No, that's not called investment. That is called trading. That is called making money out of it. That is what is happening with cryptocurrencies. Student put 10,000 rupees, and after 1 week, he takes out 80,000 rupees from the cryptocurrency. So that is what he's buying and selling immediately to bring it out. It is not growing in a natural fashion. Something which grows in a natural fashion, which has an appropriate amount of rate of return, which is expected, will be terminal to something called an investment. Okay. Whether it is short term or long term. I hope I'm able to make it clear when it comes to investment and others.
So thank you, Professor Aman. But we have got the shortage of time. We have touched 9:06. I know we could have gone on and on. And thank you all for sending your questions. I'm sorry we could not take all those questions. But we are recording the thing. I'm sure there will be a way to get those questions, and maybe we can share with Professor Aman later on after extracting them from the recording. So thank you, Professor Aman. Gratitude to you. Thanks for making it very engaging and sharing your knowledge on what was a very fascinating talk. Thanks on behalf of the Technovate team and also on behalf of Intera IT. So thank you, everybody, colleagues, guests, for sitting through this absorbing session today. So the event has been recorded and shall be shared, as Joya had mentioned earlier. Joya, you were a wonderful host today. Thanks very much. Good night to some of you. Have a great day. Bye, and signing off.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Goodbye.
Thank you so much.